thank you for coming to this afternoon session. I'm going to be moderating, and we'll try and keep everything on time as much as we can. I'm also giving the first talk in this block on reproduction and sex. And I'm Travis Ingram. I'm currently at the University of Otago, which is in Dunedin on the South Island of New Zealand. And I'm going to be talking about some work that I did when I was doing my last postdoctoral fellowship at the University of Texas at Austin with Dan Bolnick. I'd like to start by acknowledging Dan and our two co-authors on this study, Kelsey and Racine, as well as our funding sources. And I'd also like to thank the large field team that was indispensable when we went to collect this data, a large team of snorkelers, boaters, and processors that really did make a huge contribution to the study. So the topic of the study and of my talk today is assortative mating, which we can define loosely as any correlation between the traits of mated male and female pairs. This is often studied at the level of assortative mating between populations or between discrete morphs or ecotypes within species, but it also occurs within unimodal populations that don't show any discrete structuring but still show correlations between male and female traits, such as body size, here shown for a cichlid and for a number of studies of water spiders. A recent meta-analysis by one of my co-authors, Kelsey, found that across many studies, across a wide diversity of animal groups, there's a consistent trend for assortative mating to be positive, above zero, meaning a positive correlation between male and female traits, for just about every taxon and just about every trait category that she looked at. And this has a number of implications. Some at the population level, assortative mating can reduce the production of heterozygotes and can, in some conditions, inflate either genetic variants or alter patterns of covariance. There's also a potential implication for the process of speciation, which is one of the things that really interested me, where in cases where speciation occurs with gene flow, in models of synthetic or parasitic speciation, disruptive selection on an ecological trait can reduce the fitness of intermediate phenotypes, and as a result can favor individuals that mate assortatively with similar individuals, and therefore reduce the number of intermediate phenotype offspring that they produce. And this has the potential to contribute to speciation with gene flow, especially in cases where ecological selection and mate choice act on the same trait, the magic trait. There are other ways in which assortative mating can occur. Just one of them is mutual directional preference. So instead of the extremes of the phenotype distribution preferring each other, you can get a directional sexual selection where, for example, large size or high body condition is preferred by both males and females. The larger individuals mate with each other, and smaller individuals mate with each other by default, not because they prefer smaller mates. Whatever the driver of assortative mating, it may be reduced if there are costs to being selective, costs to choosiness, and this may occur because there's a high risk of mortality, low mate density, skewed sex ratio, or it's otherwise costly to wait because there's a chance of failing to reproduce. And assortative mating can also arise through co-segregation based on habitats or space or time, where similar phenotypes tend to either occupy similar spaces or mate, breed at similar times, and therefore mate with each other, not due to preference, but due to where and when they're mating. Stickleback are a pretty attractive system in which to address the overall prevalence of assortative mating, as well as to try to identify some of the drivers that might contribute to variation in assortment among populations. Best known is assortative mating based on body size, which occurs between sympatric and parapatric ecotypes of stickleback, including benthic and limnetic species that co-occur within lakes, and anadromous and stream resident stickleback. And in these pairs of ecotypes, it's been found that assortative mating is based on, in large part, on body size, which is divergent between ecotypes, and also the basis of self-referential preference for large or small individuals. Most of this work has been based on lab studies, and it can be challenging to observe enough matings in the field to determine the prevalence of positive assortative mating across many populations. But work in the bowling lab previously, especially by Lisa Snowberg, has found that there are positive associations between the diet of males and females within lakes that contain a single stickleback population. And here you can infer the correlation between male and female diet based on the correlation between male and egg stable isotope values. I'll explain that in a few slides. And we can make some predictions about how the prevalence or the strength of assortative mating may vary across populations. First, we can predict that if disruptive selection does favor greater assortative mating, then lakes which have a stronger potential for disruptive selection. And thanks to previous work in some of these populations, we know that these are lakes that have intermediate amounts of littoral and pelagic habitat. So more equitable distributions of habitat types favor disruptive selection and maybe assortative mating. We can also predict that when there are costs to being too deep present, there may be less assortiveness in those populations, so due to either low density of mates or we'll focus on high risk of predation. And finally, we can make the prediction based on previous work in stickleback that some preference based on size and also some habitat post-segregation may contribute to any assortative mating by diet that we see. So we expanded those previous two studies that looked at assortative mating by diet to 16 populations located on the west coast of Canada, most of them on Vancouver Island, one on nearby Quadra Island. Each of these lakes contains a single stickleback population. And they were selected to cover a variety of lake sizes as well as other attributes that could lead to variation in the strength of pressures that drive assortative mating. So in each lake, we had a large field team of snorkelers that would swim around, identify males guarding nests, measure characteristics of the nest, collect males and their eggs, not usually quite that many, but collect eggs that are in the nest, pass the males and eggs back to shore, and then we would process the males and the eggs for stable isotope analysis. This is generally what the isotopic landscape looks like in stickleback. So in these single-species populations, there's a lot of individual specialization in diet, which is reflected in the stable isotopes of the fish. And in lakes in general, and in the food webs that stickleback are embedded in, you tend to get a separation between more benthic prey types, such as insect larvae, and more pelagic prey types, such as zooplankton. And that's reflected in carbon-stable isotopes. And then the secondary axis of nitrogen stable isotopes can give you an idea of the relative trophic level that each fish is feeding at, whether it's eating more herbivores or more predators. So this relationship between the two isotopes is variable among lakes, as you can see here. So we accounted for this by using the carbon isotopes as our primary dietary axis of proportion of littoral versus pelagic prey. And then we took residuals of nitrogen isotopes on carbon isotopes to remove any relationships between the two isotopes and to get a relative measure of trophic position of each fish. So that works for the fish, and we also confirmed that we can use the isotopes of the eggs that are found in a male's nest to get an idea of what the female that mated with that male has been eating. So in three lakes in which we were able to get good samples of gravid females and their eggs, we found strong positive correlations between the female isotopes and the egg isotopes. So we can use the eggs as a proxy for what the female has been eating. So what happens when we look at these male-egg correlations that we're using as proxies for male-female correlations? Here's carbon isotopes for just one lake. The male is on the X and the eggs are on the Y. There's a bit of a positive correlation, R0.2. It's not significant, you kind of have to squint to see anything there. Let's look at another lake. This is nitrogen isotopes in a different lake. It's marginally stronger, it's maybe a little more visually convincing, but again, not even significant. So we can't really rule out random mating within these lakes. And I'm sorry to say these aren't two randomly selected lakes. These are the two strongest correlations that we ended up finding in any of the 16 populations. So this is what that looks like if you look at the estimate of the male-egg isotope correlation, as well as the confidence interval around that. None of them can exclude zero. But if you take a look at what the distribution of correlation coefficients is, we have one negative value, a bunch clustering around zero, and then the majority of them are positive, but only weakly positive. So if you do kind of meta-analyze those 16 lakes and look across all the populations, the overall strength of the correlation is slightly greater than zero. You get a mean correlation coefficient of about 0.075. It's significant, but again, quite weak. And for nitrogen, for this measure of relative trophic position, there's really nothing going on there. No overall tendency to be positive or negative, and again, no individual lake showing significant deviation from zero. So, unfortunately, we don't have a lot of variation among lakes in which to test our hypothesized drivers. We can take a look just to see if we can explain what variation does exist. So remember, for disruptive selection, we had predicted that we should see this hump-shaped relationship with the littoral pelagic ratio, which is a measure of how much benthic and how much pelagic habitat there is. And we don't. In neither case is the quadratic term significant for that measure of littoral pelagic ratio. We predicted that cost to choosiness, such as higher risk of predation, and this is density of predatory fish estimated from a number of snorkel contacts in each lake. We found, rather than our prediction of a negative relationship, we found no relationship for carbon and a weak but significant positive relationship for nitrogen. So counter to our predictions, we're not sure if this is due to some other impact of predation or if it's because the density of predators was correlated with something else we didn't measure. And finally, we could predict that if it's actually body size that's the basis for mate choice, which we have a lot of evidence for in stickleback, that in a lake with a stronger positive association between the size of the male fish and the isotopes of the male fish, we should see stronger assortment by isotopes just because of this correlation as a secondary effect. But again, the strength of the correlation between fish size and fish isotopes doesn't predict how strong assortment is based on isotopes. And the last thing we did was to take a look at the potential for habitat co-segregation. So if males that eat a certain thing tend to build their nests in some habitats, and males or females that eat the same thing also spend their time in that same habitat and mate with the male just by chance, then we'd expect habitat to explain most of the variation to explain the pattern of assorted mating. We did see some patterns of isotopes within lakes being related to habitat characteristics, such as nest depth and the presence of vegetation around the nest, but they weren't particularly consistent, and when we adjust for habitat by taking residuals from these models, it doesn't affect any of the results, which are no compelling assortative mating within populations and a very weak trend for positive assortment across populations. So that overall trend based on carbon isotopes is consistent with other work, but this very weak magnitude may help to explain why speciation hasn't occurred in these single species stickleback lakes. And we don't know if that weak positive assortment is based on some small amount of preference for diet itself, if, for example, males and females that eat the same thing have similar olfactory cues and prefer to mate with similar smelling individuals, or if it's based on other correlated traits. And again, unfortunately, because we don't have a lot of variation in assortiveness among lakes, we can't be too confident in our test of these hypothesized drivers. And to really get a good test of those predictions, we need to find systems with a lot more variation among lakes in the strength of assortment. Thank you very much, and I probably have time for a question. No questions?